Please stand. The eternal God is your refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms.
The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies are new every morning.
Eye has not seen, nor ear heard, nor the heart of man conceived, what God has prepared for those who love him.
We believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so it will be for those who died as Christians. God will bring them to life in Jesus. Thus, we shall always be with the Lord. Comfort one another with these words.
Heavenly Father, in your Son Jesus Christ, you have given us a true faith and sure hope. Help us to live as those who believe in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to eternal life, and strengthen this faith and hope in us all the days of our life, through the love of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. Amen. Good morning to you all as we come into this space to celebrate the life of Ntate Jonas Musa Victor Gwangwa. We welcome the following dignitaries with us: the Mayor of Johannesburg, ministers and deputy ministers present, the South African music and arts legends, leadership of our church joining virtually, faith-based organization leaders, all guests and officials from various sectors, and the Gwangwa family and relatives and close friends. I really, just to the family, want to say that 2 weeks ago we were here to bid our farewells to Mayor Violet Gwangwa, and so really our love and our prayers are with you as we gather here this morning. I would like to read a message from our bishop. On behalf of Mountjoy and the Anglican Diocese of Johannesburg, I would like to take the opportunity to express our sincere condolences to you as a family on the passing of your father, Ntate Jonas Gwangwa. The scripture that immediately comes to mind is Wisdom of Solomon, chapter 3, 1-3, which says, "But the righteous people are protected by God and will never suffer torment. It is a foolish mistake to think that righteous people die and that the death is a terrible evil. They leave us, but it is not a disaster. In fact, the righteous are at peace. May his soul rest in peace and rise in glory. Please be assured of our prayers as you mourn. Shalom, yours full of grace and peace, the Right Reverend Dr. Steve Moreo, Bishop of Johannesburg." And so, in the name of Christ who died and was raised by the glory of the Father, we welcome you. Grace, mercy, and peace be with you all, and also with you. We will now light the Easter candle, and as we do so, we will pray this prayer together. Blessed are you, Lord our God, lover of souls. You uphold us in life and sustain us in death. To you be glory and praise forever. For the darkness of this age is passing away, as Christ, the bright and morning star, brings to his saints the light of life. As you give light to those in darkness who walk in the shadow of death, so remember in your kingdom your faithful servants, that death may be for them the gate to life and to unending fellowship with you, where with your saints you live and reign, one in the perfect union of love, now and forever. Amen. Now I invite the family to come forward and light the two candles. And as we light these two candles, it is in loving memory of those who live on forever in our hearts. We will now listen to the words of our first hymn being played.
Thank you.
to now call forward our program directors, Executive Mayor Jeff Makubo and MEC Mbale Hlophe, to please come forward. You may be seated.
Minister Mthethwa, DM Mokoetla, ANC leadership is represented by Membete and Comrade Dakota, leaders of the religious community, family of Ntate Jonas Kwangwa, and relatives alike, and all the fellow mourners. Today we're here to bid farewell to a life well lived. Ntate Jonas was not just a musician, but was an activist in his own right, a jazz maestro celebrated within the country and throughout the globe. As we come here today to mourn his passing, we also ask that we may celebrate the life that he has lived. Today's proceedings will be run by both myself and the mayor, and we'll take you through the day, and truly, let's make sure that we celebrate his life and honor his memory. But importantly, never forget the important contribution that he has been able to make within the music industry, but importantly, within the freedoms that we enjoy today. I'll ask the mayor just to join me. We will be taking you and co-chairing, or rather co-program directing, today's proceedings. So we'll be here with you today. If you could just give us your ears.
Minister, Deputy Minister, ke lebise tlhompo go ba lelapa la ga Kwangwa. Ke re tshedisegang Ntate Kefa Semenya, baruti, the clergy. We are here in Sofa Town. I'm a grandson of Sofa Town. In fact, I worship here at Christ the King. Together Ntate Kwangwa ne re le kereke ya rona e. Ke re dumelang. I would like us to rise and be led with the national anthem. I'm not sure if you can all rise for the national anthem, please.
Thank you. You may be seated. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. We're first going to begin by getting a family tribute. If the member could just please come forward.
I'd like to say good morning to all the distinguished guests, the mayor, all the ministers, the clergy. I would like to say good morning also to you, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of the Gwanga family, I would like to begin by acknowledging and thanking everyone that is here today, all who are watching from home, and those who have sent their condolences. The family has received countless phone calls, emails, texts, flowers, meals, visits, thoughts, and prayers. These have been both comforting during this difficult time and have been a reminder of the impact that Jonas Mosa Gwangwa has had on so many in our nation. My name is Richard Mokata, and Buti Mosa, as I used to call him, is my cousin. His father, Malume Wilson, is my mother's cousin's brother, and we all lived in Orlando East, and his home at 812 Hevimdingi Street is still standing and has recently been declared a heritage site by the city of Johannesburg. He was more like my older brother. I knew him since I was young, a young boy attending Nazareth School at St. Mary's next to Orlando Stadium. This was in the late 1950s, and we used to go past his home, my uncle's house, when we walked from school for many years until I finished high school. During that time, he had managed to leave the country, as many of you are aware. I have good memories of Buti Mosa when I was young. The most memorable occasion is when he made it possible for me, my siblings, and my parents to go and watch the musical King Kong at the Wits Grace Dorm. It was such an unforgettable experience, which was further entrenched in my mind by the King Kong record that we always listened to at home. When he left, we kept close contact with his late wife, Sis Violet, who later joined him in Botswana. When they returned to South Africa, it seemed as if they had never left the country at all. Our bond was still very tight, and we have since kept close contact as family. Besides our family ties here in Johannesburg, I think it is just as important to mention our strong connection with our roots in Ramarava in Kalkspruit, Limpopo. This is where our parents came from, and Buti Jonas had made sure that we do not lose ties that we have with our family there. He and his wife have even built their second home there on a plot that was once occupied by my late uncle, my mother's eldest brother. An occasion that will not be forgotten there is when he performed with his band and all the people in the village attended. I can count many occasions where we were together, but Buti Mosa and Sis Violet, with me, with Buti Mosa and Sis Violet as family. And the most significant occasion was when we traveled together to Accra, Ghana for my niece's wedding. We really enjoyed ourselves and further bonded. I can mention many instances where my brother has been supportive to me personally, and these are too numerous to mention. For the past few months, I have watched Buti Mosa fighting very bravely whilst his body was slowly giving in and his health declining. Through all this, he still managed to give a smile when he saw me and other people next to his bed. I can keep talking about our moments together, but like I said at the beginning, that would take lots and lots of time. On the 23rd of January, my dear brother passed away. and he left an empty space in my heart. And I believe in the hearts of all in the family, a void that nobody can fill. The 23rd of January was one of the saddest and most painful days in my life. That day I got the call that my brother had passed on. It is a memory that I cannot erase from my mind or my heart. Although I told him lots of times that I loved him dearly, I would give anything to turn back time and tell him that I loved him one more time, to tell him that without him my life is not complete and that he is an important and special part of it. People say that time heals all wounds, but today I can tell you that I find it hard to believe. Till today, I feel the same pain in my heart that I felt on Sunday. I know he is closer to me, that there is no more distance or time difference that separates us now. I thank him for those years of love and friendship that he gave me. I thank him for everything that he did for me. I want him to know that I love him with all my heart and that I will always remember him. He will always be my brother and my dear friend. With these few words, I would like to express my sincere thanks to all who cared for Butmosa during his illness, and especially to my sister Violet in the other realm. To his children, Papi Spenki, Mpo, Mujalifa, Mark, Malusi, Kitu, Neo, Smanga, Zoli, all the grandkids and all the great-grandkids, I say thank God that you had such a great father, grandfather, and great-grandfather. Please honor his legacy by being the best that you can. I also thank Mani Lebu, the many aunts and uncles, cousins and family who were there to ensure that they lend a hand. I'd also like to close by saying these words. I thought of you with love today, but that is nothing new. I thought of you yesterday and days before that too. I think of you in silence as I often speak your name. All I have are memories and your picture in a frame. God has you in his keeping. I have you in my heart. Your life was a blessing, your memory a treasure. You are loved beyond words and missed beyond measure. Farewell, my brother. Greet the Lord for me. Being your brother has been an honor. Thank you.
Thank you, Butuchet. God, the master musician, has called upon one of his own to join him in eternal harmony. We gathered here today because life has been interrupted, but not just life, music and jazz are interrupted. The disapproving, piercing ring of death has sadly overcome the music and melody of life and jazz as we know it. Who else can pay a musical tribute to a friend of a long time, a fellow musician, a legend in music, than Tate Kefas Katsisimenya? Please come on stage to pay a tribute to Tate Jonas.
Dumelang ba haetsu putoa ya modimo ya ratehang sane bonane ba ntwagiti molweni mawethu abusheni. Good morning to all of you, ladies and gentlemen. Mr. Program Director and Miss Program Director. Program Director, Your Excellency Mayor Makubu. Program Director, me Mbali Hlophe, Minister of Arts and Culture and Sports, Nathi Mthethwa, all ministers and members of parliament who are present, the Honorable Premier Ntate Makhura, all protocol observed. I have to pay tribute to a very dear friend and it's a life that one cannot relate or narrate in 2 minutes. Actually, we need a whole book to do so. But I've kind of put something together, truncated it, so at least to give you an idea of who he was and what he meant to us. For me, is indeed a spiritually complicated day for me today. Not only me, but my family as well. And by family, I mean my wife, Leta. For those who don't know, she comes from Orlando East as well. She was neighbors with Ntate Gwangwa. You know, I never dreamed that one day I would be standing and speaking in front of a congregation speaking about Gwangwa the way I'm going to speak about him now. 2 years back, unfortunately, I was also one among many mourners who came to Hugh Masekela's funeral to bid him farewell. Before that, Jonas, Hugh Masekela, and myself sang the song Hush at Miriam Makeba's funeral. Another year, I was at Aus Dorothy's funeral. Another one, Sis Tandi Mpambani, Tandi Klassen. And I keep watching all these people that I grew up with in this business as each and every one of them departs. That's why I say today is a spiritually complicated day for me. Because in my own mind, I ask the question, why? Why had they left this world so soon when there is still so much for us to do here in this beloved country of ours? I don't know where the answer will be coming from, but it is truly sad that all these giants of our music and arts are passing away one at a time. The first time I met Gwangwa, I was a teenager. I was 16 years old, and he was 17 years and 11 months older. Hugh was 16 years old, like myself. I met them at a concert and dance performance in Benoni at the Davy Social Center. Both of them, Hugh and Jonas, were members of the Huddleston Jazz Band, and I was there with my group, the Katsinjama Kids. From that time on, when we performed together on one stage, we got to know each other. And from that time on, we frequently met at many other shows together, and we got to know each other. very well. I don't know if many people know that before Ogwangwa went to the States, or before he became the musician that he finally became, around 1957, he, Hugh Masekela, Dollar Brandt, Makaya Njoko, and Johnny Getz formed a band named the Jazz Epistle. The leader of the band was Brakipi Moeketsi. Brakipi was an experienced alto sax player who had played with many big bands in South Africa, and he was experienced enough to be their teacher in playing jazz. He taught them many things that as youngsters they didn't know. In 1959, the Union of Southern African Artists, with its headquarters in Dokke House on Elof Street, launched the famous musical King Kong. The cast was made up of South Africa's cream of the crop musicians, singers, and dancers from the townships. Dambuza Mdledle played the leading role as King Kong. Miriam Makeba was the leading lady. All of us youngsters, Boomer 16, 17, and so on, were in the cast, and we were dancers and singers. Jonas and Hugh, young as they were now around 17, 18, played in the band alongside the older musicians who were much more experienced than they were. But they were in there, they hung in there, and they did a good job. In 1961, the Union of Southern African Artists, which had produced King Kong, now sent us, when I say us, I mean I was also a member of the cast, but sent the cast of King Kong to London to perform there. Jonas was there as well, but was only there for 2 months because he left for the US after he'd been there for that little while. He left for the US to go study at the Manhattan School of Music, where Hugh Masekela had already been. Hugh had left in 1961 on a scholarship that was arranged by Miriam Makeba. And in 1964, I too went to the States with the musical Sponono, which was produced again by the Union of Southern African Artists. Many people know the place as Dokke House, but that was the headquarters. It was not Dokke House, it was the Union of Southern African Artists. And the union was put together by people like Bobo Denpo, Makay Davashe, Wigwe Mukwebi, and many others that many of the people gathered in here wouldn't know their names or know their faces. But these people were very special. Without them, there wouldn't be a Miriam Makeba, there wouldn't be a Ledambulu, Jonas Gwangwa, Hugh Masekela, Haifa Siminya, I can go on. And they were really the people who made us who we are today. They were the inspiration, and they protected us from the ravages of apartheid state. They formed the Union of Southern African Artists, and they took care of us. And that's why Jonas went to the States, and it was because of the union. Hugh went to the States, Miriam also, because of the union. So anyway, once we were in the US together, like I said, I left in 64, and I joined them there. After Sponono folded, I stayed behind because Jonas and Hugh said, why don't you stay here and study music as well? Because we know that you've always wanted to study. So this is your chance now. I stayed. It was difficult to stay in the States at that time because I'd left family behind. But because they were there, both of them, Miriam was there, and many other activists were there from home, I didn't think that it was wrong for me to join them. And I really joined them and became a part of the exile family. And so once we were there, we started working together on many projects, which culminated in us three forming our group, the Union of Southern African Art, of the Union of South Africa. And if you know anything about the Union of South Africa, the rest is history. Before I conclude, I just want to say that Jonas Musa was my dear friend and a colleague in music. If I were to say that, it would be a gross understatement, because to me, Jonas Gwangwa was much more than just a friend and colleague. He was family. He was a brother and a comrade in arms. We were bound together, not only by our love for music, but also by a common goal of using our musical talents as a weapon to free our people from the shackles of colonialism and apartheid oppression. All five of us, Sister Miriam Makeba, Hugh Masekela, Jonas Gwangwa, Leta, and myself, collectively made a conscious decision to become the cultural wing of our people's liberation movements that were waging the liberation struggle for freedom, justice, and self-determination. And by joining the ANC's Amandla Cultural Ensemble and eventually becoming its musical director and artistic leader for many years, Gwangwa truly earned his credentials as a dedicated, politically conscious musician and revolutionary. As a trombonist, singer, and composer, Gwangwa had his own special sound and style. His music spoke volumes and still speaks volumes. The words he sang in his songs, such as Batsumi, which you just heard, and the hymn that he sang, and others, all of those songs still bear witness to the caliber of musician he was. The least known about Jonas Gwangwa was his incredible sense of humor. If you knew him like I know him, you would understand. You would understand. I'm laughing because of some of the stuff that he used to say. He was very funny, and he used to make up all kinds of hilarious stories. He used to jokingly say to us, "You know, Mura, at the age we are now at, which of course we were now in our 80s, you know, no, late 70s, like 77, 78. He says, at the age we are at now, we are patiently waiting in the departure lounge of the airport to the other side." And the first time he said this, I mean, we were taken aback. So what? He said, "We are waiting at the departure lounge of the airport to the other side." One day, the bell through the airport sound speakers would ring, ding, dong, ding, dong, and the announcer's voice would come in and say, "Attention, attention, ladies and gentlemen, flight number such and such to the next world is ready to board. And please, those people who are booked on this flight, should now get ready to make their way to the boarding gate. And the announcer would announce the gate, gate number such and such. And then he says, and he would laugh heartily and say, and that's us, Mora. When that day comes, that bell will ring. It's very, I'm laughing because how correct he was. The bell he spoke about so many times, it did ring for him. And he did go to the boarding gate. And I'm sure Auswei, Austin Dengi, his wife, was waiting to welcome him on the other side. Oh, Tundate Gwangwa's family, Spenki, Mujalefa, Mpo, and all of you, Kere Humutsahao, Lifu Halitwa Ilehe, Kehatseba, Impa Arena Matahore Rakahana, Hemudimu Aroma, the announcer at the airport who released that bell ring, ding dong, ding dong. All who are booked on this flight should now carry on to the gate, flight number so. And that flight is waiting for us too. One day we will have to answer the call. Thank you.
Thank you for those warm tributes from the family, Tate Mogate, and also a colleague who has lived his life with him over the years, Tate Semenge. Your tributes speak of a man who lived a great life, a giant in his own right. You paint a very colorful picture of a man who was not just a musician, celebrated throughout, but was also an activist who used his art form to raise our national consciousness and also to raise the plight of what was going on in this country so that he too may be part of those who liberate us so we enjoy the freedoms that we do today. We had indicated earlier that he was not just a musician, but was an activist. And on behalf of the military veterans, I'd like to call forward Ntate, our dear Minister, Deputy Minister, Thabang Mokoetla, who's going to speak and give us a narration of the other life that he lived as an activist. Thank you.
Our program co-directors, thank you very much for the opportunity. Allow me to acknowledge the bereaved children of Comrade Jonas Gwangwa and Sis Vai and the extended Gwangwa family. To acknowledge also the Honorable Minister of Sport, Arts and Culture, Minister Nathi Mteto. To acknowledge the former National Chairperson of the ANC and Speaker of Parliament, Ms. Baleka Mbete. To acknowledge the Speaker who was here before me, South Africa's celebrated icon, composer, musician, and lifetime friend of Comrade Jonas Gwangwa, Mr. Kaifas Brakatsi Siminya. our spiritual leaders at this funeral, all privileged dignitaries present here today to witness the final farewell to Ntate Musa Jonas Kwangwa, fellow mourners. The celebrated African writer and cultural worker Chinua Achebe says, and I quote, "From the very beginning, it seems to me, stories have indeed been meant to be enjoyed, to appeal to that part of us which enjoys good form and shape and good sound. Still, I think that behind it all, still, I think that behind it all is a desire to make our experience in the world better, to make our passage through life easier. Once you talk about making things better, you are talking about politics." He then says, and I quote, "I believe that it is impossible to write anything in Africa without some kind of commitment, some kind of message, some kind of protest. In my definition, I'm a protest writer with restraint," unquote. This perspective of Chinua Achebe about his own life, I believe it is true of the legacy of many African renowned artists, such as Jonas Kwangwa and their artistic exploits. Program co-directors, it is a singular honor and a privilege to me to have been asked to join our distinguished speakers at this funeral, who have been asked to deliver the final farewell message on behalf of the vast humanity which Comrade Jonas Kwangwa journeyed with in his illustrious life, including the community I have been asked to represent. Bra JG, as he was popularly known among the many people around him, was a people's hero. As a person, he seemed to prefer saying less when you encountered him for the first time, until he opened his mouth, always somewhat reluctantly. But his humor, as Bra Kaifa Semenya has just said, could leave you floored, while he continued giggling innocently with a naughty smile over what he had said. He was a real cold assassin when delivering his hilarious anecdotes, which were always written not for public consumption, for your ears only. Like his companions, Huma Sekela and Bra Kaifa Semenya, Comrade JG was an agent of the spirituality of our people. His love for freedom was genuine and deep. Sometime in the year 1980, the rumor mill in MK camps in Angola went into overdrive, intimating that the celebrated jazz musician Jonas Kwangwa was in Luanda, because he is also a member of the ANC. It was a story which was initially hard to believe. For over two decades after her independence in 1975, Angola remained a war zone, as we all know. Everyone without exception who went to Angola or was based in Angola within the ANC had to carry a gun to know how to use it, and at least for his own protection. It was an immense inspiration to many in the camps for Bra Kaifa to have foregone life in the glamorous cities of the United States and became part of the trials and tribulations of the lives of those who were involved in the prosecution of the armed struggle. Later on, an update of this rumor followed, suggesting that Jonas Gwanga was now training and honing the Amandla Cultural Ensemble of the ANC into a professional musical stage show. This was exciting, firstly, because of the huge anticipation of what Amandla was destined to be, but also for the enhanced profile our struggle and our organization was going to acquire both at home and abroad. Those days, we needed friends, and we valued friends. In this mission, Bragwangwa's passion and professionalism was pleasantly matched by the discipline and dedication of the young MK soldiers who were assembled for this project from the camps. He caused their intense rehearsals to run from 6 to 6, that is 6 in the evening until 6 o'clock in the morning. As fate would have it, it was in the middle of those preparations that he met the dreadful car accident that left him badly wounded and some of his comrades dead. Everyone still talks about how, after this accident, he still insisted on coming to rehearsals on a stretcher with some of his limbs immobilized in the plaster of Paris. As a result, he missed the first tour of Amandla to the Norwegian countries of Sweden, the Netherlands, Norway, and Denmark in 1980. However, when he returned from this treatment, he led the group on tours to African states in 1981, to Eastern Europe in 1982, and to Britain, France, and Japan, and Brazil in 1984. In his endeavor to professionalize Amandla Cultural Ensemble, Jonas Gwanga had recruited another colorful trumpet player and militant cultural worker from his hometown, Orlando East, the late Dennis Mpale. Amandla Group became a powerful weapon in the arsenal of the ANC in the drive to educate the world about our struggle and to win friends across the globe to our cause. Thanks to the immeasurable work accomplished by Comrade Jonas Gwanga, program directors, I am pleased that the next speaker on the program, I noted, is a person who personally worked with these two icons and together with Dr. Wally Sirote led the ANC machinery which transformed Gaborone into the mecca of South Africa's revolutionary cultural movement. These renowned cultural workers to whom Bra-JG belonged demonstrated that culture could become an effective weapon of struggle. It also for this reason that the apartheid military plunged into Botswana on a killing spree of civilian members of the public on the 14th of June 1985. Jonas Gwanga was a true people's celebrity. In his lifelong national service to our country, he remained a companion of many mere mortals because he was comfortable among the less fortunate and those who enjoy recognition equally. His collaboration with the military community did not end with the struggle against apartheid. He continued to be a friend of the People's Democratic Defense Establishment, the South African National Defense Force, after 1994, because of his understanding that the military will always be populated by many young people who need exposure to a variety of opportunities. He collaborated with the South African National Defense Force in several initiatives to impart skills and experience in the field of music. In 2014, he performed with the South African Air Force Music Band at the Standard Bank Joy of Jazz in Sandton. In 2018, he performed with the South African National Defense Force Mass Band at the Air Force Day in Kimberley. In the year 2000, the then President of the Republic, Honorable Thabo Mbeki, commissioned Jonas Gwanga to compose the song for the occasion of the unveiling of our new national coat of arms, which he rendered with the music band of the South African National Defense Force. Before Comrade Jonas Gwanga's demise, Captain Ndlovu from the South African Air Force was writing music with Jonas Gwangwa with the aim of producing a live DVD recording as a tribute to his legacy. Musa Jonas Gwangwa is no more in our midst of the living, but his legacy and spirit will live in our communities and our hearts forever. He delivered freedom and brought joy to our people. We in the military community will miss his companionship. We mourn with South Africa this loss. Mokgapa o mogolo o weile, Baswana ba rialo dithaga re lla botsoror. May the spirit of the Prince of Gama Shashani live on, and may his soul repose in eternal peace. I thank you.
Thank you very much, Deputy Minister. The hymn Yehlamoya that was sang, well, it was played earlier on, it's one of our favorites. It reminds us that Jonas Gwangwa, Tate Jonas Gwangwa, would actually link hymns to freedom songs, because as youngsters we used to sing that one as a freedom song, adapted from a hymn through the work of Tate Gwangwa. A Czech writer, Milan Kundera, reminds us in his book, Laughter and Forgetting, that the struggle of man against power is a struggle of memory against forgetting. In keeping the sound of South Africa, particularly the oppressed majority, Ntate Jonas Gwangwa was at the coalface of reminding those in power that we'll never forget who we are, and we'll never forget how to be free, no matter how long it would take. Thank you for the tribute, Deputy Minister, Comrade Thabang Makwetla. The next speaker will join us via Zoom. We know that we are living in difficult times. Ordinarily, would be in a very, very big marquee with a band, the Ntate Kefas, Arlala Zipinkomo, Mama Matswale and others celebrating this musical icon. Let me introduce, as we acknowledge the presence of the member of the National Executive Committee, Ntate Takota Lekgwete, who's just joined us. Let me introduce the former chairperson of the African National Congress, the former speaker, former deputy president, Me Balekambete, to pay tribute to this musical giant, Mbete.
Thank you, joint program directors. I greet the family of the Gwangwa and the Mulebatsi children and relatives who are with us. The arts and culture fraternity globally, and the family of the ANC and Alliance as a community, as well as South Africa at large, as we are all watching and are linked to this moment of grief. We gather to pay our respects, to celebrate and bury a great artist and musician of the people, Bra JG. We have come to give an appropriate send-off in spite of COVID limitations, to say farewell to a jewel, to a national treasure, one of royal blood who chose to forgo the salutes that go with that in order to carry the trombone as a weapon of choice, a weapon that oozed divine sounds. He came from a long line of decades-old trends of artists in the struggle for liberation whose voices, pianos, trumpets and drums, dramas and movies called our people out from fear and depression, from slumber or drunkenness, from numbness and defeat, to reclaim their pride, courage, and their smiles. The founders showed the way. Me Charlotte Maxeke, me Nokutela Dube, with their voices, went out to the world to hone and sharpen every possible weapon at their disposal, to woo resources for adding to our people's arsenal to fight for our freedom. I came across Dr. Jonas Gwangwa and other South African exiles in Gaborone, Botswana in 1983. The Medu Art Ensemble was a cultural vehicle that mobilized exiles, locals, and expatriates from the international world. We were a well-organized ANC community in all the structures determined by the relevant pillars of struggle at that stage of our revolution. Given the proximity of Botswana to South Africa, there was a lot of underground work and interaction with people coming in and out of South Africa. So for instance, you would be an ANC branch member, but at the same time, a member of the Women's League or Women's Section at that point, the Women's Section branch, and a member of the unit of the Medu Art Ensemble or two, which you would have been a member of. And these units would have tentacles into South Africa in terms of the work they were doing, because we were very much in touch with our people. From time to time, we'd organize events and festivals that attracted large numbers of South Africans into Gaborone. Many young South Africans would end up going for military training in circumstances like that. Comrade Jonas Gwangwa and I were members of the Med unit, music unit, of which his band, Shakawe, was the most active. It was the most active part of that particular unit. Comrade Steve Dyer, Dennis Mbale, Tony Sidras were also members of Shakawe. One of the more well-known actresses in South Africa today, Ms. Connie Ferguson of the Soapy The Queen, was with us in Medu. In each of the Medu units, serious discussions were held and lectures were given to members of those units by the more educated members. For example, in the writers unit, they would be writing workshops to which comrades' own poems or short stories were brought and were used as illustrations, and the collective would be helped in how to improve their own individual writing skills. To this day in Botswana, Jonas Gwangwa's name is revered as the founder of a jazz audience in that country. Shakawe, Bragwangwa's band, and Brahu's Kalahari were the most popular groups in that country. In that milieu, a lot of mobilization, political mobilization happened. Locals and expatriate citizens got persuaded, and they in turn hosted and supported a lot of our activities there in Gaborone at the time, in their homes or other spaces that they had access to. During red alerts, and red alerts would be when the our security structures would come and let us know that the agents of the apartheid South Africa were in town. and anything should be expected, and it was not advisable to stay or sleep in our homes. And so you then have to scuttle to find somewhere to sleep, somewhere to take your children, and so on. So during those alerts, we often needed places to sleep. And Bokani Dyer's mom, who was a university student at the time and was highly pregnant with Bokani, she let me spend 2 nights in her room during that time. So this is just to practically illustrate her, to illustrate the kind of life that the exiles at that time were living. Botswana's exile community and its proximity to home, and I say home in capital letters, was in certain respects the dream community. And I hope in a future National Democratic Society, some of the elements of how that community lived would obtain. I say this in respect to the ability for individuals in a community to be afforded space and good company wherein everyone was supported by the collective to develop in the areas of choice in the arts. That way, people gave their best. In that environment, we lived with Pragwangwa and Sis Vai and their family. We all brought our children up within that environment. Pragwangwa often went away for long stretches of time to pursue the orders he had received from President Oliver Tambo in the camps in Angola, which Comrade Thabang has talked about, where he had to nurture and develop young talent and develop the Amandla cultural ensemble. This became a very effective, lethal international mobilization instrument, crisscrossing the globe with the message for the people of the world to isolate apartheid South Africa in support of our struggle. This went a long way in making more in the international community to finally get it. Program directors, the last 2 years were like a nightmare. Rajay lying in bed, unable to play his trombone. I think Sis Vai also should not have left when she did, because I believe she deserved an award for her remarkable role in nursing him through this past period. No wonder he couldn't stay long after she succumbed to COVID. Today, we lay him to rest. We will continue to study the book of his life. To pursue his many dreams that were not yet fulfilled. Especially on how best, as a democratic state, we should advance the lot of artists and cultural workers to fulfill the dream of President John Langalibalele Dube and the dream of President O.R. Tambo. Sithamba kahle project. Hamba kahle mkhonto amandla.
John Doan reminds us
in his famous sonnet, "That Death Be Not Proud." He says to us that whilst death comes into our lives like a thief, stealing from us those that we love dearly, those that we believe has so much more to contribute, and those whose physical presence will forever be missed. He says to us that death should not be proud, because whilst it's able to steal those we love from the physical reality that we live in, what it's unable to do is to make us forget them as they live on. They live on in the work that they've done. They live on in the memories we shared with them. And so we are able to constantly make sure that as we speak about them, we give life to their memory. And that is one thing that death cannot steal. And so death should never be proud. In the process and in helping us to constantly remember Ntate Gwangwa and his contributions in our lives and those of society alike, I'd like to call forward to come and read the obituary, Mompho Gwangwa Nxumalo.
Good morning, my relatives, my family, and the dignitaries, the clergy, all protocol observed. This account of Papa's life first appeared in the conversation on the 23rd of 1/21 and is republished under Creative Common License. And it was written by Gwen Ansell. Music is not a zero-sum game with only one best. But if you seek to name one musician whose life embodies the South African people's struggle for a national culture, it must be a trombonist, composer, cultural activist, Jonas Musa Gwangwa, a son of the late Wilson and Sophie Gwangwa, who was born on the 19th October 1937 in Orlando East, Johannesburg, and died on the 23rd January 2021 in Johannesburg, aged 83. Through 65 years on stage, Papa's playing contributed to every genre of South African jazz. Overseas, he was hailed as player, producer, and composer. Yet, he chose to step away from mainstream success for 10 years, leading the Amandla Cultural Ensemble of the African National Congress, to win hearts of the anti-apartheid struggle everywhere and present a vision of what post-apartheid national culture could be. He battled painful injury. Accident shattered the same femur three times, was hunted for his life by the regime's forces, and experienced both the heydays of South African liberation culture and far more ambivalent times since. Throughout, he cherished a half a century plus love affair with his wife, our mother, Violet, and brought his family scattered across half the globe, home intact to a free South Africa. Violet's death only a few short weeks before his had left him and the rest of the family devastated. Papa started his career in the 1950s in the Father Huddleston Band at St. Peter's College in Johannesburg. When instruments were allocated, he wanted a clarinet, but he didn't know what it was called, and instead muttered trombone. When a huge piece of brass was brought to him, he looked at it, amazed, but too shy to refuse it. There was music in the family, lessons at school, and from American jazzmen on the bioscope screen at the Auden Cinema in Sophiatown. From Dizzy Gillespie, the schoolboy, Gwangwa borrowed his lifetime trademark, a jaunty black beret. He became, in his own words, the little Bipupa. Politics shaped Gwangwa too. The 1954 Bantu Education Act ended Father Huddleston St. Peter's, but not before the band had played at the adoption of the Freedom Charter in Cliptown. He said, everybody shared a perspective. You didn't even classify it as being political. Nobody separated the music from the politics. Because trombone was a scarce sound in African jazz bands, Gwangwa's tricky chops caught the ears of the elite jazz dazzlers. His vision expanded with the jazz epistles, whose jazz epistles verse one became the first modern jazz album from a black South African band. That was the first of several firsts. Gwangwa was co-copyist for the first all-black South African stage musical, King Kong, traveling with the show to London, starting a lifelong love affair with a stage musical format, words, action, and music. And in his words, he says, I became fascinated, that is, when interviewing Baba, I became fascinated with just how to put all these pieces together. Then London contacts helped Gwangwa secure a place at the Manhattan School of Music in New York. There, sharing a flat with Hugh Masekela, his MIEG allowance went as often on gig tickets as food, as he imbibed mainstream classics and the new free jazz. Equally active in politics, he helped organize South African students in America and served as the first eye on the text drafted by old school friends, poet Keurapetse Kgosietsile of Miriam Makeba's 1963 anti-apartheid address to the UN. He worked with Makeba and Harry Belafonte, most famously as arranger, adapter, and conductor for the 1965 Grammy-winning Best Folk Album, An Evening with Harry Belafonte and Miriam Makeba, another first. Then came residencies, film scores, multiple recordings across genres, musical directions and tours with the Union of South Africa, and with Hep Alpert, when the trombonist won seven curtain calls for a barnstorming solo on his own Foreign Natives, despite its painful interruption midstream by the reckless driver who first crushed his leg. Gwangwa's American jazz star was rising, but he had loyalties bigger than the stage. And this is a liberation movement. In 1980, Gwangwa answered the call from the ANC president, O.R. Tambo, to score the military camp of Angola for young talent to establish the campaigning Amandla Cultural Ensemble, The call was too politically important to ignore, and the opportunity to create an entire stage show excited Gwangwa so much that sometimes couldn't sleep. He spent most of the next decade between Amandla rehearsing in Angola and touring the world and Botswana with his family and contributing to the local cultural scene with the Midu Arts Ensemble. In both settings, he was an innovator. Botswana musicians say he helped build their professionalism and shifted their focus towards indigenous inspiration. In Amandla, he consciously revisioned traditions, casting female performers in previously all-male traditional dance roles. Why not? This is a liberation movement. Some cynical analysts suggest Amandla's winning musical arrangement and dramatic stage interludes simply preached up struggle culture for overseas audiences. They missed the point. Gwangwa's love for the struggle was genuine and deep, never cosmetic, and he couldn't have written an unattractive tune if he tried. Gwangwa believed that political theater deserved exactly the same high aesthetic standards as any other stage performance. And according to the memories of other Amandla performers, he enforced these relentlessly at rehearsals. Audiences everywhere responded to that combination of passion and professionalism. Amandla's impact put the Gwangwa family home on the SADF hit list for the 1985 raid in Botswana. It was raised, fortunately the occupants were elsewhere, and the regime's hunt did not cease. Roots were pulled up again for London, then America. During that uneasy, unsettled time, Gwangwa scored another first, an Oscar nomination, and more for his Cry Freedom film score, co-composed with George Fenton. For the People, finally home again in 1991. Some recognition arrived. Orders of Ikhamanga for him and Amandla. Commissions for various official and Pan-African corps, honorary degrees and more. Yet he still constantly struggled to earn from tours, shows, and recordings, encountered record label problems over material deemed political, and stage composer was not who he wanted to be. Although he was committed to the new South Africa and happy to contribute, he really wanted to be on the ground with the guys. He told me in 2019 from his sickbed, doing something important, he was saddened by the globalized, commoditized, official perspective on the arts, by the sidelining of everything Amandla had tried to build. His music has always explicitly been his weapon, and we're still within an era of struggle. In June 2019, Gwangwa was struck by a serious illness that left him bedridden. He struggled valiantly towards recovery, but was never bitter. Interviewing him for his forthcoming biography, which this obituary is part of that autobiography, when Gwen Ansell asked him what he was proud of, and he said, Amandla, because it involved all the things in music that excited me the most and gave me the opportunity to bring them together. For the most important reason possible, it was for the people. Hamba kahle Mkhonto. Papa will always be remembered and fondly missed by his family of 7, 18 grandchildren, 12 great-grandchildren, his sister-in-law, nephew, and nieces. Bolisiva. At Melan. Litovalega, Gunkucho Murunga. Mroana was on a boom. What goes Wagakuangua?
Tialelo chaba gethu ra le dumirisha batho beshu lo a jamela empelekeno kulisiba maraba
lo a jamela empelekeno kukhumbeni le sija Moses kwangwa
tukumaraba go suka ke ntlone bukhosi ba mantabelo ba ka maraba e Kalkspruit
ke maraba go tloa Kalkspruit le fasting la Limpopo Kalkspruit
lapha go emijune ngwanya malewe le le
bona mo go ileng yo dunye yona ko ngwe nya mejwe e ileng ye
es banga le se mushate wa se Kalkspruit ka maraba
ba ke sa mushate wa Kalkspruit ka maraba
ba ga gwangwa ba rona ba kosi
bana ba ga gwangwa bana ba kosi
na bo gwangwa ba oke
le bo gwangwa ka moka
se tshaba sa se Kalkspruit ka maraba
se tshaba sa Kalkspruit ka maraba
Matabele o ke kusuka la go fike Zimbabwe.
Matabele ka moka o tloa mo o fitla Zimbabwe.
Le Limpopo ke bophara.
Le Limpopo ka bophara.
Tialelo cha bakethu.
Sa lelo cha ke moka. Ra le dumisa ka moka.
Ba re la ba boka la batho ba balele.
Batho ka moka ba ba badilweng.
Ba thumele molaetsa gore a moya wa gwangwa o thobaleke go thula.
Ba rometse molaetsa gore a moya wa gwangwa a robale ka kgotso.
Baru baga kwangwa
batho baga kwangwa
bona Jonas lo murwana wa kosi
yena Jonas kwangwa o ke ngwana wa ngwana wa kosi
papa ke go soma bonu Wilson kwangwa
papa ke soma bonu Wilson kwangwa
mkhulu kosi
ra kholu kosi
u tseke gugu na dlonke
u tshiri gugu na dlonke
pabela tha Wilson soma bonu anentwa
pabela ga go soma bonu
Somapu,
Somapu,
Farello. Yaba Goyam Rana and Entra Ninake Gugakelo Natunga Atongapa.
Yaba and Analiti of Kela Gugu, not longer at Hokofa.
Kulukosi, eh, Tagaku, Nakanya.
Rakulukosi, Aja Gugu, Wanakanya.
Ah, Kutaga Gugu Nakanya, Nabe Utobella Tabu Hadi Monica.
Mona Matlavela Tabor Hadi Monica.
Someone William.
Rangwane William.
Now Hadi Josina Stagam Quadro.
Left Hadi Josina Jam Quadro.
Guillaume Michel Lintota, Guillaume Michel Lintota, listen to Sanganigayo.
Giacavaki and Amunur Sakaningayanam.
Jenna, Togumarab.
Jolin Nakilimarab.
M. Shatuagabarab.
M. Shatuamaraba.
Kusavana go to Nala Baga Kwangwa.
Tswalana le ba ga kwangwa
ndo le suka kati na ka 17th century le go bo maraba sekwala ba sabeletwa
ke ntwe itlogang kgolo ka bo 17th century le bo maraba sekwala ba sabelego
bo kwangwa la ba khonyana ngale ka maraba
bo kwangwa ke ba khonyane ga maraba
bo maraba la ba se a tekelana thina ndo ba re ba ka kwangwa
bo maraba le ba ga kwangwa ba nyalelana
ka Monday kwangwa u vuka e go mutsana
kwa u tsoga ile mutswala
ka le bompile
ka la bobedi
o vuka e go malome
o tsoga ile malome
ka le bothatho
ka la boraro
nna thoko malomakhe
nna ke malome a gage
ka le bone
ka la bone
thoko songwanakhe
ke songwana thoko songwanakhe ke sendebele yes ke ra ngwana gae
ka le bohlano
ka le ka Friday
kwangwa khae mushato o ri tya ka nkhulu
kwangwa gae mushato o ri tya ga ragolo
ke mokibelo
ka Saturday
marabalo khae ka kwangwa o ri tya ka nkhulu
mara ba ga ya gore ke ga ra gholwaka
ka sonta ga se tenta friends ba rwana ba morusi ya
ka sonta ga re dutse around the table raja
se tla se tutu ne nya
re ja bo gobe le nama
nthanda go lubonisa
re nya ka go lubontsha
gore kwangwa lo wa getho
gore kwangwa o kwa ka gae
e bile ka phanda lo go jika jika
ka ntle go jika jika
nga tletse ba mpa tlene a swa ka mashashane muru
Kwangu aswaga masasana.
Nsilinge kaholo.
Eh, in kwatisha kudu.
Lo kwa mo mukosu usabi wenda uni.
Se mukosu utabua pleke.
Awi na pauka bitoko.
Awi ko mosabi chongo.
Di khalimalo makwala na lama pelelo.
Ke khalimalo matomelo lama fele.
Wasakalspread.
Wakalspread iko wakalspread.
Wakamasasana.
Masasana ke masasana.
Ayasi angkhonu ko yaba muru wakamasasana tumutse senga.
Ake khonu ko utswa muthwa kamasasana kamisha kalspread.
In khalimalo.
Re khala fela mo.
Nje.
Joali.
Kitoreta sreto saka kwangu.
Kitoreta sreto saka kwangu.
Sreto sele pasile la sakal spray.
Le sreto sele sakal spray.
Kulesi saka kwangu.
Kulesi sakal spray.
Mfuna kurana na bela ngari tasbala. Anta ngwala ndro pasi sale tenga tsene ndro letse.
Anke ke ngwala selo fasi di gona mo mading.
Mara to se somela kahle gore le seve gore sreto yi striker.
Ke tlo se bolela botso re le sekwe mara ka stebele gore le tshono sekwe.
Ka stebele.
Mpo thamalanga ke tshege.
Ke a tuka joali ke tuka mollo.
Lo atlhobele lo
wa robetseng o
lo atlhobele morana soma bono wa kwangu
ke ngwana soma bono wa kwangu
bo sibongo senginge nene sibongo sibongo ba rwaneng sa bongo ba rwaneng se a bubuka
ke sibongo senginge nene go tshela go kgirela ya no a seng itloka khwetse sorelo
bo sibongo senginge nene sibongo sa bongo ba rwaneng se a bubuka Mundo wabo ngwechana masila sila.
Lili.
Situkulu sa manje o lokgo thata gotho miswa ka kwa. Le bone la bo ramkonu wa bokosi o le phatha mundo e khukulu.
Lili.
Bandu babo bo patiki wa bo manenga sokgwele. Setlarala la semarogwa ma tshwana.
Murunga we.
E kha bo musu go bona mba dutse ba kude ba ya tshumpela.
Malu.
E kha bo se hlahliso kupheka mbhodza emathubini yabo mashawo akulwana. E kha bo nasi sikotwana simutswiri magongwa o tempele. O tempele mphokatse u bonelo kwa le jangkola ne mkhure. Khamba ka tlhe se go go bana se sentima. Ke ngwana a tlhogang ka spray ga mara ba sekwalana ka itlo le kotlo ba ramaka. Mogara se itse saka ditau. O ri bua le mang nna ngwana go bokwang. Ba go setse jeng ka feritse ke le khabelle ga di manantong go setse go se ya mere ba molodo lengwa nantlaneng ga ga mothiba
batho ka we
na le bone na ga le bone na le thubegile ke rena le bone na ga ba bone na motso ga xana ba re ngwa ba re phio tse tloga dipatagang mo la bona ba ba di mulhong re bona ba dipatagang ma bo o tsitse le boela la phaseng la maune ka mo go la matuludi go lewa sa masetlapelo sello go bane di le tlogolana tsa mara ba sekola Dile di bakishana go tloga. Mongwe a re e sa pele go sepele nna wa raro. Mongwe a re wa sepela le nna ke tlo go latela. A gona mona ka botsomolo la bakhwiti. Ke ra fana le bona ka botsikhala ka le losola ba botsikana. O rile a re ke le go sheta tsaba o dula ka khotso. Maphatla ba hlomong ka gana ga le sele. Ngwana a tebele tona mapangola. Ngwana modula thuko ma une. Re sa tlo reng ba diphetile badimo. Re sa tlo reng bona beng ba re amogile. Re re ga mokgobe ya lefishare le betse go lebella tsorong. Antu bona be mma di mirere ba iphetile. Ba phetile gore ba gore go motseng masogana mmeng. O ka ema di metse. Go isa go tlhaka kirikitletse. A tla la mo le bana go senya le yao. Ba ka la mo le ke mangalo gona ke dioma go. Ya mma betse bo sele mauna ona batho. Ba bona nna le senya ga be mahlo le khotlotse. Thibang di tshuba me shi thunyele ga phiritsere.
Batho ka we.
Program directors and to all of the speakers. As we prepare for the Word of God, we will have a hymn being played.
He said, "You would be." ya exoda tema gaule golo tya boraro tema neng ya boneng itse a Jehova bona uba wa fapuha go tla sheba modimo wa mmitsa o le hara sehlahla wa re moshe moshe a re ke neno modimo re kopana le moshe o disitse dinkutsa Jethro o tswa lefatsheng la egepita bolaele mo egepita o tla a kgathetse le diphoso modimo o mo bitsa ka ra diphoso tseo modimo wa rona ga re mo ananele re mo mamele ga re bitsa le ga re ana diphoso le ga re bitsa re le matshwenyego ga re
gorona. Listen to the holy word of God as recorded in Paul's letter to the Romans in chapter 8, beginning to read at the 31st verse. What then shall we say in response to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all. How will he not, along with him, graciously give us all things? Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through whom who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Hear the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Now may the words of my mouth and the thoughts and meditations of all our hearts be ever acceptable unto you, O God, our strength and our deliverer. Amen. You may be seated. A jazz community without Gwangwa is hard to imagine. I recall this particular time experiencing him in a festival where he played his classic Flowers of the Nation. And I felt as though the entire universe was in agreement with the sound. That evening I left thinking, Gwangwa composes anthems. These anthems now live to comfort us, and perhaps the most immortal part of an improviser's life is his or her songbook. And if we go with this notion, then Gwangwa lives to eternity. His stories through his sound will be told to our grandchildren for many generations to come. Now, these are not my words. These are Nduduzo Makatini, a South African jazz pianist, a composer, philosopher, and a healer through sound, an artist of our times, as he meditated on Ntate Jonas Gwangwa's passing, and I think they're quite apt words. Now, I wish to greet all present here today to comfort the Gwangwa family and to grieve the passing of Ntate Jonas, Minister Mthethwa, Ntate Makwetla, Ntate Semenya, our co-program directors, the Mayor of Johannesburg, Ntate Makubu and Mayor Hlophe, MC in the province, and also all others who are present, protocol observed. I'd like to greet you all in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. My name is Mpole Samuel Masamola. I'm an Anglican priest down the road in Linden, I was a priest here just before Reverend Colette, and thank you for your graciousness inviting me and still trusting me with this pulpit. Thank you. Now, I'm sure that the family is feeling the love and support of all of us who are here, especially all the tributes that we've heard today. Bakagwangwa, be deeply consoled. Our deepest condolences. Our deepest condolences, especially for the double blow that has hit you in recent days. Recently, we met here in this church to remember Mayor Vai, where she and Tate Jonas and the family, and her and Tate Jonas would sit round about that part of the church there. And also, we meet in this church where his music has been performed here by the likes of Herbie Tswairi and his quartet of the young lions of today's jazz, and also in the hall there by Tabogo Mokoena and The Void and The Atoms. We meet here today to bid farewell and to share the memory of Ntate Gwangwa as we did that of Mevai not so long ago. So our deepest condolences, family. We cannot begin to pretend that we understand your pain, Baka Gwangwa. Please receive our sympathies and God's comfort during this time of great sorrow. Indeed, it shall seem as though we are losing many who are going in close succession. It's like an era that is stabbing the soul of the nation over and over again with a dagger. I'm sure we've heard of the passing of Mayor Sibongile Khumalo yesterday, the First Lady of Song, unbearable succession of losses. We are taking quite a lot in as a nation. And may her soul rest in peace and rise in glory. And so we gather today and we take refuge and comfort in the words of St. Paul in today's reading in his letter to the Romans. Even as we are gathered here, we are reminded by the scriptures that even during these difficult times, nothing, absolutely nothing, can separate us from the love of God in Jesus Christ our Lord. And before I proceed, just like to unpack just something particular, words that went out on Wednesday. These are Pope Francis' words at the Vatican in his weekly Wednesday general audience. He wrote something that I think would be to the liking of Ntate Jonas's brand of humor. The Pope said, "It irritates me a little when I hear Christians who recite verses from the Bible like parrots." The Pope doesn't like Christians who just churn out verses and yet not take them in and not have them marinated in their lives and marinating their lives and the world around them. I'm sure some of you know Christians like that. And I have to confess that there are times when I'm like that. So I think it's good to remember Pope Francis' words that it can be irritating to just churn out verses like parrots. The likes of Jonas Gwangwa are those types of Christians who lived the verses. We heard today about his brand of humor, about that waiting in the departure lounge. You can find words like that in St. Paul and you might even miss them, but he managed to take them into his life and his brand of humor oozed those verses. That even as death attends to us, we are not lost, we are not forgotten. It is a departure lounge. And as the Tsotsis like to say in Tsotsital, ubodile, you are in the body, you are now boarding the plane and going to the other side. Now Ntate Gwangwa lived the verses. He didn't just churn them out like a parrot. His life was like a soundtrack or even an anthem that God and the universe somehow agreed with. Nduduzo Makatini heard the universe agreeing with Jonas Gwangwa's rendition of The Flowers of the Nation at that particular concert, and I just quoted his tribute. Now we are able to hear in today's text, we are able to hear it agree with the anthem that is Ntate Jonas Gwangwa's life. Nothing can separate us, nothing can separate Baka Gwangwa, nothing can separate Ntate Jonas
from the love of God in Jesus Christ our Lord. Nothing. Now, the celebrated black theologian and currently professor of public practice and philosophy at the Harvard University, who's also a lover of the blues and jazz, also a churchman and a jazzman, Dr. Cornel West says this: justice is what love looks like in public. Justice is what love looks like in public. Now, if we take these words and we try to use them to interpret what Paul said to the Romans, we might just come across this, that Ntate Jonas Gwangwa's life was the expression of love and justice in public. And this came from his powerful upbringing by the likes of Father Trevor Huddleston, whose life was justice as love in practice. They didn't just quote verses, they lived them, they became an anthem. And so it is not surprising that someone whose life is an anthem of the good news of liberation, the good news of justice, the good news of fighting oppression, that their music would do the same. So in as much as the universe agreed and still agrees with Ntate Gwangwa's anthems as they are played, his life also agrees with the gospel of love as justice in public. As a matter of fact, there's still a picture that Reverend Colette has in her office of Ntate Gwangwa, just to show you how much this root, this faith, and his practice in politics and music were so woven together. There is a picture, a collage of pictures, in fact, in the office at the back there of Ntate Gwangwa, Mevai, and Father Trevor Huddleston on his last visit to South Africa. His life was not fragmented, even as apartheid tried to fragment it, separate family, even with his broken bones and being cut away from family and the country that he loved for a long time. His life, his testimony, was so woven together, was so integrated. Justice is what love looks like in public. Who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Nothing can separate us from love. Nothing can separate us from the pursuit of justice. Trouble didn't separate Ntate Gwangwa from public display of justice. Did hardship separate him? No. Did persecution separate him from the love of God in Christ? No. Did hunger, with that small little stipend that was mentioned in one of the tributes, did that little stipend, and sometimes days when he wouldn't know where food would come from, did that separate him from the cause of justice, which is love in public? No. Could the many years in exile separate him? No. Not even the shattered bones in his femur could separate him from the love of God in Christ. On the contrary, Ntate Gwangwa modeled another piece of scripture, which was penned by the same St. Paul in chapter 5 of the Romans, and I'll read verses 3 to 5. St. Paul says, "Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance. Perseverance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love and God's sense of that which is just in our public relations has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us." So I'm not surprised that Ntate Gwangwa introduced a hymn, even in the trenches, that speaks of the Holy Spirit who comes, because you can't separate the Holy Spirit. If you really know your scriptures, you can't separate the Holy Spirit from the cause of justice. His life was so integrated. He didn't just recite verses like a parrot. He modeled and lived them. He loved his wife. and they've now crossed over together. He loved his children and grandchildren. In fact, the Ntate Gwangwa that I know couldn't bear living at a separate address from them. He really conquered separation because of the love of Christ in his life. Let us comfort ourselves in just that. He modeled in the flesh what love is and what justice is, in his humor and in his pursuit of every single project that was put before him. And so we can. The greatest tribute would be to take a leaf from Tate Jonas's life and put it in our lives and live eternal truths in time and say, thy kingdom come, O Lord, make me an instrument of your justice in South Africa today. Make me an instrument of love of neighbor. Make me an instrument that lives out the verses and doesn't just parrot them. Now, I want to draw to a close, and I just want to share with you a last comforting meditation on Ntate Gwangwa, and that is his name, Jonas. Now, Jonas is a favored name among the Hebrews, and historically the Hebrews who lived among the Greeks, and therefore spoke Greek. The name itself means a dove, which to the Greeks was a sign or a portent that are sent from the gods to bring good messages to humanity. And so the Hebrews took this image of the dove, and for them, it represented God's message of peace yet to be accomplished. And isn't that just what Ntate Gwangwa lived for? Not only did he live the verses, he lived the true meaning of his life. He was a man who knew that the road to peace may not be easy. It will go through suffering, might go through persecution, it will go through a whole lot of trouble. And yet all of those will build character and integrity that ultimately says peace. And if you looked at him perform on stage, especially when he was not playing his trombone and just waiting, and you looked at his face, you could see that dove. You could see that Jonas. That will never escape our memories. That is our comfort, that God gave us a portent of peace through this man, who, when we look at today, we realize that his life even unpacked the scriptures. He gave us an interpretation of what Christ might mean today. Not just a thin religious, spiritual perspective of it, but what the love of God is, what the love of wife and family is, what the love of children and grandchildren is, what the love of comrade means, what the love of a good cause for freedom is. And nothing could separate him from any of those. May it be that we are comforted, even as we ourselves are encouraged to know that we are never separated from God, and that in the works of justice and of mercy that we engage in, God is with us. Yes, and Ntate Gwangwa has crossed over to the other side. The choir and the big bands and the big small bands on the other side are growing. The many anthems that he wrote for us will keep ringing in our hearts. And his life, which is a soundtrack of love and peace, will also remain in our hearts, for it has made a deep and an indelible mark. This is the spirit of the one who is more than a conqueror, whose life spoke volumes. May it be that the spirit of God who gives peace and comfort comforts you, Ditlo Matebela Maholo. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Let us now enter into a time of prayer. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. God, our Father, your Son, Jesus Christ, died and rose again for our salvation. We entrust to you the soul of your servant Jonas, praying that he and all the faithful departed may be revealed as your children when Christ shall come again to honor with you and the Holy Spirit. Be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. We pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Merciful Father and Lord of all life, we praise you that we are made in your image and reflect your truth and light. We thank you for the life of your son, Jonas, for the love and mercy he received from you and showed among us. Above all, we rejoice at your gracious promise to all your saints, living and departed, that shall rise again at the coming of Christ. And we ask that we may share with our brother that clearer vision when we shall see your face in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Almighty God, you are the source of all good thoughts and deeds. We praise you for the life of Ntate Jonas, for his concern for others and for his many acts of kindness. And we commend him to your love and mercy, by whose mercy and grace your saints remain in everlasting light and peace. Father of all, we remember with thanksgiving those whom we love but see no longer. And we pray that in them your perfect will may be fulfilled. Remember, O Lord, this your servant, who has gone before us with the sign of faith, and now rests in the sleep of peace. According to your promises, grant to Ntate Jonas and to all who rest in Christ refreshment, light, and peace. We commend all people to your unfailing love, that in them your will may be fulfilled. And we rejoice at the faithful witness of your servants in every age, praying that we may share with them in your eternal kingdom, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I would like to now invite the Executive Mayor, Jeff Makubu, to please come forward.
Pororo, Ulibambeling Ashoni, Renaissance Song, Temporary Inconvenience, Flowers of the Nation, Let the Music Play On. Minister, even in death, the music does not stop, the song goes on, perhaps a bit differently, more nostalgic, more subtly beautiful, but it goes on. At the request of the Premier of Gauteng, President Ramaphosa declared this funeral a special provincial official funeral. We shall now, as we rise, ask Colonel Qaba to march forward and bring the flag to the minister to hand over to the family before I invite you to stage. Colonel Qaba. Let me welcome on stage the Minister of Sports, Arts and Culture, Minister Natin Tetwa, give the eulogy.
program directors, MEC Mbali Shope and Mayor Geoff Makubu, to the Kwangwa family, Ms. Bimbete, former Speaker of Parliament of the National Assembly, the Deputy Minister of Defense and Military Veteran, Honorable Makwetla, our legend, Ntate Caiphus Semenya, Ambassador Masikela is joining us online, I think. MMC's councillors here present, creative workers of our country, the living legends, representatives of the media, distinguished audience, ladies and gentlemen, fellow compatriots. The country, South Africa, mourns the loss of a legend, an icon, an incredible talent, a humble son of the soil, a father and a brother, when he closed his eyes for the last time on the 23rd of January 2021 to join those who went before him. Just 17 days after the loss of his beloved wife, whom he met almost 70 years ago and shared an incredible love story with through decades full of trials and separation forced upon them by the cruel policies imposed by the oppressive apartheid regime, Dr. Jonas Musa Kwangwa followed her. He defied the popular inscription that says, "Till death do us part." They have said even death will not separate them. This is the enduring love they had for one another, which is showing even now. Gwen Ansell is preparing a very informative and deep thoughts about this giant. And most of the lines here would be stolen from her soon-to-be-published book. Today we've gathered here to pay homage to one of the finest talents. Jonas Musa Kwangwa is of that powerful generation that gave us hope when those who were in power at the time thought they had managed to kill the spirit of freedom. This generation inspired us and urged us to defend our humanity. Through music, Jonas Kwangwa and his generation fought against apartheid and in the process endured much pain and sacrificed the best years of their lives so that we can live in peace and in a democratic society. At this very point, at every point of the way, Jonas Kwangwa, you were not content only to fight against, but you knew what you were fighting for. You embraced love, hope in your music. You asserted a proud and defiant love for humanity and what it means to be human. Your songs contributed to the making of the memory of our people. It was not only nostalgic, but also an assertion of a people's culture. It was an appreciation of his work that made his own country to award him on an order of Ikhamanga in gold in 2010 for his contribution to music and the struggle for freedom in our native land. Hugh Masekela, Oliver Dugum Dugutsi and Jonas Kwango may be sending us a particular message when they both depart on the same day, though in different years. Brahuma Sekela and Jonas Kwango started their music careers as young teenagers. And this part, well captured by Bragatsi, who grew up with him, and we are not going to be going to deal with that, except to say that it was important to have this account from somebody very close, from somebody who knew who brought Jonas Kwango was. Always asserted that politics and culture cannot be separated. And at that point, when both Deputy Minister Bagwetla and Mayor Baleka Mbete spoke about Amandla and what Amandla did to conscientize the community of South Africa in exile, it rang a bell that inside the country. So the proliferation of Amandla ensemble inside the country, mimicking Amandla led by Bra Jonas Kwango. It is at this stage that the youth of South Africa, so the proliferation of the cultural groups, and these cultural groups were very much aware that culture is a potent weapon for change. And culture was used by young people to change this very country. And as it happened, that after all was done by Amandla, the time came for the liberation movement to be unbanned. And when the liberation movement was unbanned, his work was honored by his country, because his work earned him many accolades, locally and abroad, such as the Oscar, Grammy, BAFTA, Golden Globe, and Anthony Asquith Award nominations received for the original score and theme song for the film Cry Freedom. The score achieved and won Ivor Novello and Black Emmy Awards. In 1988, he performed at the Nelson Mandela 70th birthday tribute concert in Wembley Stadium. And after his return in 1991, he composed the theme for South Africa's 1997 Olympic bid. Excuse me for that. He's a recipient of a Summer Lifetime Achievement Award in recognition of his work and various honorary doctorates from several universities. But his words that reverberate most are, and I quote, "The priority of teaching ourselves how to be proud of being African through our cultures is the highest of honor bestowed on creatives," close quote. Dr. Jonas Kwango and few others, Mayor Dorothy Masuk, the late that the Kaifa Semenya, May Abigail Gubega, and others were our point of reference more than 5 years ago when we approached them and made a proposal that there's so much work, there's so much wealth, heritage wealth, which have not been captured properly. They are the contributors of that heritage wealth. So we need to find a way of preserving this legacy, their legacy. We need to be celebrating their work. We need to honor their work whilst they are still alive. We emphasize the point that we need to take a journey with the younger generation to have that intergenerational exchange through masterclasses and other ways. That is how the Living Legends Legacy Fraternity was born. It was born out of that, out of the understanding that we can't have this work of these giants wasted. Their work is all over the world, and we need to find a way of archiving them, and they are their own captains of that particular journey. And I'm glad that it's through them that we're able to start that process. We saw the annual general meeting last year in November taking place, and later the leadership coming out of that, where Dr. John Gani is now the chairperson of this very important body. This is important so that we don't only talk about the giants during this time, but we are able to ensure that their work is understood, because with Amandla, the point has been made that you can use culture to unite our people. When I interacted over a period of time with that Jonas Kwango, one matter he emphasized about Amandla ensemble is that it had all the ethnic groups of our country. The Rainbow Nation we spoke about in 1994 started long time ago when Amandla ensemble was put together with him at the helm. It was against this backdrop that in 2015, we relaunched Amandla in this country. Again, interacting with Ndate Jonas, that we can't have this treasure called Amandla just going to waste, because it is through Amandla that inside the country, young people were mobilized, particularly under the UDF and COSATU, and having the cultural desks. And we wanted to relive Amandla in South Africa. And indeed, it was launched in 2015. It started touring the country, but that work didn't go far. It was cut short. Underlying in so many of his composition lies his message that freedom for some is freedom for none. Ndate Kwangwa will be gone, but never forgotten. Because through his music, he will live on forever in the hearts and minds of all of humanity. And for those of us who were privileged enough to have met him, his warm personality, quick wit, and great sense of humor will linger on with the notes of his trombone. Hamba kahle qhawele sizwe. Hamba kahle mkhonto wesizwe. Thank you, program director.
Thank you very much, Minister Mthethwa. Tate Semenya, I'm sure there's a reunion of jazz pioneers and cultural icons happening above us. While we are grieving for them down here, they are up there playing their instruments in holy harmony. If they would, they would tell us not to worry that we feel the pain at their leaving, for they knew that they are never really gone. The music will make sure of that. We've come to the end of our program, of this service, of this official farewell to a musical giant, an activist par excellence, a freedom fighter, a revolutionary, a leader, a father, grandfather, an uncle. He's got blue blood. Ntate Jonas Musa Vitakwangwa. Myself and the co-program director, MEC Mbalihlophe, would like to thank you for giving us this opportunity, really, to direct the program and for working with us. We are way past the 2 hours allocated because of the COVID regulations, we need 2 hours. But Ntate Semenya did say that it needs a whole book. This is a story of 65 years on stage of contribution to humanity, of fighting for freedom, of enriching our lives. So therefore, it cannot be told in 2 hours. We really tried. Thank you very much, Reverend Colette Saldana, the priest in charge at the Christ the King Anglican Church. Linda Temasemola Murduaga. Realeboha. Let the work of Father Trevor Huddleston continue. Thank you very much from us. I don't know if you want to say a few words. Thank you very much from us. It's time for announcements. I don't know who will do the announcements. I was not given a name. We were not given a name. And of course, we'll hand over to Baruti after the announcements. So, Barifemo, Salemohau. Thank you very much. I think I speak on behalf of both of us, MEC Mbalihlophe. Thank you very much. Kimang the announcements, Osimpo.
Once again, good morning. This is not just a big announcement. Following what Ntate Makhubo has said about Papa being royalty, from here, this session is going to end. We are not going to be going to the graveyard, as indicated. Royalty is sent off in a different manner, and that ceremony has already taken place. Thank you.
So we now come to the part of the service where we commend our beloved Ntate Jonas Gwangwa to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Heavenly Father, by your mighty power you gave us life, and in your love you have given us new life in Christ Jesus. We entrust Ntate Jonas to your merciful keeping in the faith of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who died and rose again to save us and is now alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit in glory forever. Amen.
Almighty God, Father of all mercies, and giver of all comfort, deal graciously with those who mourn, that casting all their care on you, they may know the consolation of your love through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Rest eternal grant unto him, O Lord, and let like the petrel shine upon him. Please stand as we have the final blessing. May the road rise up to meet you. May the wind always be at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face and rains fall soft upon your fields. And until we meet again, may God hold you in the palm of his hand and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. As we allow our beloved to return to his Creator, so we say, Jonas, may the angels lead you into paradise. May the martyrs come to welcome you and take you to the holy city, the new and eternal Jerusalem. May the choir of angels welcome you, where Lazarus is poor no longer. May you have eternal rest. And so we go in peace to love and to serve the Lord in the name of Christ. Amen. We will now have the final hymn as we process out.
Thank you. parted by the mercies of God.